Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us. I'm Hugh McDermott. I'm the Communications Manager with the Michigan Department of Environment, Great Lakes and Energy, or EGLE. We're here today to discuss and take questions on the status report that was sent to sent to Governor Whitmer yesterday by EGLE. You should all have a link to that. If you don't, our great tech person, Jim, will put one in the chat for you or send it around. That link is both in the media advisory and in the press release that should have gone out about an hour ago. This report is an initial status report requested by the governor to be returned to her by the end of August, which we sent that over yesterday. And it summarizes the various investigations and reviews that are ongoing. It catalogs the myriad actions that EGLE has taken to assist local officials and residents during and after the dam failures, and discusses the actions we plan to take to ensure the remaining portion of the Edenville Dam on the Tobacco River site is safe and stable. With us today are EGLE Director Liesl Clark, Water Resources Division Director Teresa Seidel, and Dam Safety Engineer Luke Trumbull. After their presentations, we're glad to take questions on the report and the status of the various reviews and investigations that are underway. We are not, however, in a position to comment on the pending litigation involving dam failures or the status of individual dams in other parts of the state. As you all should know by now, our excellent public information officer, Nick Assendelf, who is on the line, is ready and willing and able to answers to questions that you may have today that fall outside the scope of this conversation. His contact information is on the release and pretty easy to find. I also know that we have a substantial number of non-media guests attending today. I'm hoping to confine the questions at the end to media. However, if you represent a municipality, an emergency management agency, or anyone else with questions you don't know who to ask, I again volunteer Nick or myself to serve as a traffic cop and get you to the appropriate staffer. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to EGLE Director Liesl Clark to begin the presentation. Liesl.
Awesome. Thank you, Hugh. Thanks for setting us up and getting us started. And thanks everybody for joining. When we put this together, we did not anticipate this much interest, and so we're really excited about the opportunity to have this conversation with all of you. So I appreciate you joining to talk about the report that I delivered yesterday to the governor on behalf of EGLE. First, I want to share that at EGLE, we continue to work closely with our local, state, and federal partners to help the affected community recover from their losses. We cannot overstate the extent to which the emergency preparedness planning and swift action from first responders helped prevent more disastrous outcomes. Public servants at all levels worked incredibly quickly to fight back in every way possible and protect the community. This was apparent in the long hours through the night and over multiple days put in by the emergency teams. We saw it from the wastewater treatment plant operators staying with their machinery as long as possible until the rising flood forced them to leave their posts. The commitment was also true from businesses in the community who sprang into action to engage emergency plans and make every possible attempt to help limit harmful discharges. There are countless stories of Michiganders going above and beyond for their neighbors. What was also on display is the resilience and tenacity of a community united in their response to an event that never should have happened. So we're here today to talk about this report to the governor. The historic rain event, which led to the dam failure, and the catastrophic 500-year flooding in mid-Michigan illuminated in many ways the consequences of inadequately investing in our state's infrastructure. It also points to potential improvements that should be made in policies, procedures, funding, and regulation. EGLE is eager for the results of the ongoing investigations and reviews. The outcome of this work will analyze and provide recommendations for the path forward. I'm very proud of our team's work every day, of our commitment to leadership, making decisions rooted in data, and partnering with the communities that we serve. This tragedy reminds us that risk cannot be eliminated entirely, but people shouldn't have to go to bed afraid. So what's in the report? First, I'll just reiterate Hugh's point that we won't be discussing pending litigation over the dam failures and resulting impacts. What we've addressed here is a variety of things that have been ongoing over the last few months, and we think this is a useful time to stop, take a pause, and look at what we'll be doing going forward. So first, the five-member independent forensics investigation team has started their work after FERC put them under contract to do so. Boyce was obligated to come to terms with the team but failed to do so, and so FERC stepped in. And that report is expected in the next 12 to 18 months. Also, there's a report expected later this month from the Association of State Dam Safety Officials, which looked at the mission and goals of Michigan Eagle's dam safety program, our budget and staffing levels, our organizational structure, and the strengths of laws and procedures that we use. In the meantime, we are working to hire a third dam safety inspector, and we have a number of resumes in hand from very qualified individuals. Also in this report, we expect to name the members of the Michigan Dam Safety Task Force yet this week. So members there will come from public, private, academic, tribal, and environmental sectors, and will focus on how to improve dam safety in Michigan. That final report is expected early 2021. So one of the important things that is in this report as well is a catalog of the ongoing investigations that have happened, more of a technical nature. And one of the most important pieces is making sure that in our work to protect public health and safety, we're thinking about and working, taking action on the remaining component of the dam that exists. So the spillway on the tobacco side of the river. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to dam safety engineer Luke Trumbull to take us through a little bit of background on the tobacco side of the dam.
Thank you, Liesl. Can you all see my screen?
Yes.
I can. I think everybody else is muted, though.
Okay, thank you. So as Director Clark indicated, a lot of work has gone on since the dam failure event to analyze the remaining safety of the dam. And I just put together a few slides to kind of walk through what we've been doing on that front. So the May 19th failure event caused a rapid drop in the Wixom Lake Reservoir on the Tittabawassee side, and following which a rush of water under M30, the Causeway Bridge on M30 caused failure of that bridge, and some of the water on the tobacco side remained, and that creates concerns over the safety of the remaining dam. So in response, Eagle directed Boyce Hydro to hire an engineer and perform some analyses of the remaining portions of the dam to understand the safety of those structures. Here's just a quick map, and I hope you can see my pointer. If not, I'll kind of talk through. When we refer to the tobacco side, that's the west side of the impoundment, west of M30, and we refer to the east side as the Tittabawassee side, because that's where the Tobacco River and the Tittabawassee rivers met in the impoundment. Between the two is separated by a long causeway bridge that we refer to as the M30 causeway. And to the south, there's a south M30 bridge in Edenville. And you'll see in the bottom right, which is kind of the far east end of the dam, is the dam failure location. So after the dam failed in that location, the east side of the impoundment, the Tittabawassee side, started to lower quickly. Water rushed under M30. The M30 bridge washed out, and now the Tobacco River is redirected to the east at the upstream side of the dam, and ultimately through the breach that formed in the dam to the downstream Tittabawassee River. So in May, Eagle directed Boyce to hire their engineer and submit some reports that would identify and make recommendations about ongoing concerns with the dam. And those include stability of the remaining dam structures, safety of the dam during future flooding events, how that dovetails into restoration of those two M30 bridges, and any ongoing natural resource impacts caused by the failure. The reports that we received in June and July did not adequately address those issues. So in response, Eagle partnered with MDOT to utilize some available emergency funds to perform these additional engineering analysis, identify any of those concerns mentioned on the previous slide, then explore alternatives to alleviate those concerns, and ultimately implement the selected alternative, hopefully in advance of any spring high flows in 2021. So this is kind of just a snapshot from the engineer's report on alternatives. So Eagle tasked MDOT's consultant AECOM to develop and consider the four alternatives listed here. Alternative A being full breach of the dam embankment and demolition of the existing concrete spillway. That would be on the tobacco side. Alternative B would be construction of a concrete spillway at a lower elevation than is currently at the tobacco side. Alternative C, which would be full breach of the dam embankment to the left, or it'd be the west of the spillway. And then alternative D would be full rehabilitation of the dam on the tobacco side to meet current dam safety standards and reestablish full flow in the tobacco and Tittabawassee rivers. Those alternatives were scored out based on the following criteria. One being safety, second being natural resource damages, third being design and construction schedule, how quickly something could be implemented. Four would be the ongoing maintenance and monitoring of any alternative that it would be implemented. Five being the risk. And then six being the reduction in risk at the dams. And then seven would be the public and stakeholder perception of the alternatives being considered. This is just a snapshot of the conclusions of that alternatives analysis. Basically, what was selected as the preferred alternative is alternative B, and that would be the partial breach of the dam through the tobacco side spillway and lowering of the tobacco side by some amount to be determined. And it was chosen based on these criteria, basically that it did the best to address all the concerns, which was maintenance of some impoundment to limit the upstream impacts, allows M30 to reconstruct the bridges, reduces the risk with the dam safety, and it allows for future reconstruction of the dams if that's the preferred long-term solution. So the next steps for this alternatives analysis is AECOM will take that alternative through the design process and permitting processes. That should hopefully be completed this fall. There's some things that still need to be determined, which will be the ultimate elevation of the water on the tobacco side and the configuration of the dam there. And then we'll also include some stabilization measures at the Tittabawassee side to ensure that the erosion and things that have happened on the Tittabawassee River side are stable into the future. With the construction of the selected alternative anticipated to start this fall and be completed ahead of spring high flows in 2021. So there's a lot of planning and a lot of work that needs to be done, but this is a general outline of what's been going on. So that's it.
All right, thank you very much. Liesl, do you have anything to add, or shall we head into question land?
I think question land sounds great. Nice job, Luke. Thanks for the setup, and look forward to hearing what folks want to talk about.
All righty. So if you have questions, there is a question box, which you can click on the down arrow and open up and type in your question, or I believe that you can raise your hand. And I am clicking to see whose hands are raised, and there are a lot of hands raised. As a reminder, we are looking, actually there aren't that many hands raised. We're looking to answer questions from media today. If you're not media, if you're a municipal official or emergency manager, let us know what your question is. We will route it to the right person, but for now it's media. Beth LeBlanc, Detroit News, you have a question. Jim, can you unmute Beth LeBlanc's microphone, if you would?
Okay, I'm trying to mute her microphone, but it doesn't seem to be working, Hugh. Oh, there she goes.
Mine says self-muted. Beth, did you self-mute yourself?
Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Cool. Well, sorry about that. I had two questions on different subjects. So the one was, is the map that Luke pulled up earlier, is he able to show like where the tobacco spillway is that would be changed relative to the failed part of the to the Bowassi Dam. And then my other question was, I know in the report you mentioned briefly some of the results that you guys have received about contamination issues and the testing that went on there. Are you able to elaborate on that at all about what the findings were specifically?
Yeah. Luke, why don't you take the first part of that? And I think that Lisa or Teresa can take the second part.
Sure. Jim, do you want to give me control back and I'll share my screen real quick? All right.
Go ahead, Luke.
Let's get back to full screen. You should be able to see the map that I had up earlier.
Yeah.
The tobacco spillway is, if you can see my cursor, it's right here. If you can't, it's just west of the M30 bridge. And that's so when the water level lowered on the Tittabawassee side and now is redirected around the front side of the dam through the breach, which is the far east where my pointer is now, if you can see that, the flow through the tobacco spillway was cut off as that water level dropped. So the alternative B would modify that spillway to lower the concrete in that spillway to allow some flow back into the Tobacco River and divert some of that flow away from the M30 crossing so that bridge can be reconstructed and lower the pond level, remaining pond level on the Tobacco side. So does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
And Hugh, I can take that second part of the question.
Yeah. Go ahead, Lisa.
Yeah, Beth, great question. We were obviously working, frankly, up before the event and then even after the event very closely, excuse me, not only with Dow, but also with EPA and a variety of the different businesses that are located along the watershed there. So we continue to be monitoring and to receive the information that we're getting back from all that monitoring work does not give us any elevated concern. But if there's a location in particular that you want to talk about or specifics around the monitoring, we're happy to get you in touch with Materials Management Division to get you additional data there.
Thank you, Lisa. I'm going to call, and Gary Wilson, I see your question. I'm going to read that in a minute, but I'm going to call on Kelly House first, who has her hand up. Kelly House from Bridge Magazine. Jim, can you do the honors on Kelly, please?
Yeah, just a moment, Hugh.
Yep.
Okay, her hand wasn't raised, but I'm just going to mute her. Okay, Kelly, you going to mute yourself?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you. Yeah, so two questions from me. One, I'm curious what the plans for the partial breach mean for future ability to have power generation at the dam and if that impacts it. And then two, I know kind of early on in the discussion about the forensic investigation, there was some indication that there may be sort of interim findings that could or would be made public if and when they become available. Are there any interim findings that you can share at this point?
That sounds like maybe a Lisa question, the interim findings. I think I know the answer to it, but I'll let Lisa talk to it.
Yeah, sure. We'll go backwards, Kelly. Thanks for both the questions. So yeah, we are hoping to have interim findings from the forensics investigation team. We don't have any at this point. So when we get them, we're happy to share them. The timeline was a bit delayed because, as usual, Boyce didn't do what they were supposed to do. We anticipate releasing everything that we get when we get it. We just don't have anything at this point. And the question around energy generation, I also think I could answer that question, but I'm going to hand it off to Luke and not play a dam safety engineer.
Sure. Thanks, Lisa. So all of the hydropower generation equipment is on the east side of that dam. The spillway and the powerhouse on the Tittabawassee side are where the power generation happened. The spillway on the tobacco side or the west side is more just for passage of flows, you know, and helping regulate the those impoundment levels. So there's not any proposed modifications to this, what remains of the spillway and the powerhouse on the Tittabawassee side. And part of this assessment of alternatives did involve collaboration with the local stakeholders, including the Four Lakes Task Force, because it's kind of an unknown at this point what the final configuration of the dam will look like, if they are to be reconstructed, if they would utilize any of the remaining portions, or if it would be a complete reconstruction. So that decision was made in collaboration with the Four Lakes Task Force, who didn't object to the proposed modifications, such that it was a kind of a good intermediate step between now and then to allow for future reconstruction if that's the desired outcome, but also to alleviate some of the immediate concerns.
Thank you, Luke.
Thank you, appreciate it.
I'm gonna move on to a question in the chat box from Gary Wilson of Great Lakes Now. Gary, so since the dam failures, Eagle is adding one person to the dam safety staff. We currently have two dam safety inspectors / engineers for more than 1,000 dams. Great Lakes Now reporting in June revealed that Michigan trails other Great Lakes states in dam safety resources. Ohio has 12 staff, Wisconsin 7.5, et cetera. Given the risk, would it not be prudent for Michigan to accelerate the increase in staff on an emergency basis versus going through a protracted process? Liesl or Teresa, would one of you like to field that one, please?
Hey, I'd be happy to start, and Teresa's welcome to join in. So, we aren't handling this on a protracted basis. We are moving quickly. We've moved quickly to get this through the hiring freeze exemption. We are, of course, dealing with the challenge of the overlay of COVID and what that does to us from a budgetary perspective. And so I think many people are aware that the state is under a hiring freeze. So this was our very first request to SBO right away that we wanted to hire an additional dam safety engineer. We're also interested in that comparison work, not only with our Great Lakes states, but also across the nation. That's one of the reasons that we engaged previously with ASDSO and again with ASDSO to make sure that we were doing our best to benchmark against where the national averages, and then also what are the exceptional programs, so that we can have all that information and do our best to try to channel funding and support to the program to the best of our ability. As you all know, there are a lot of different things that get balanced in the budget making process, and that is always a little bit of a trick. So we will continue to have conversations with our legislative partners as well as the state budget office, and work towards getting additional support to this program. Teresa, did I miss anything?
No, you did great.
Perfect.
Good. Question. Hey, this is, I just got to share. This is cracking me up. I don't know, Jim. I'm looking at the attendees, and there are little triangles with exclamation points in them. I'm like, what does that mean? And I run my mouse over. It says not attentive. So if you're attending and you're not paying attention, apparently Big Brother is watching. So I know who's not attentive, and I'll call you out. Just kidding. Jennifer Wilson from WXYZ has a question. How would this impact Whitsun Lake? And I assume that means, Jennifer, I assume that means the partial breach that we're talking about at the tobacco side, which sounds like another Luke question to me.
Sure, thanks, Hugh. And I'll turn on my camera and see if I was having bandwidth issues, but I'll try it for now. So the Tittabawassee side of Whitsun Lake is substantially lower than the tobacco side. There is some, the remaining M30 bridge crossing, and the lake bottom is holding some water back into the tobacco side, which is the cause for concern. So on the Tittabawassee side, if the alternative is implemented, there would be relatively no change. On the tobacco side, there will be some lowering of the water level. And that, like I said, per the slide in my presentation, is to be determined through the design process. It's going to kind of be a balancing act of what the additional upstream impacts would be, in the lake and beyond, from lowering that water level and achieving the necessary safety of the remaining structure during a flood that we would need. So that's still to be determined, but I think we can confidently say it would involve some degree of lowering on the Tobacco side of the of Whitsam Lake.
And Jennifer has an additional question that I think I know the answer to, but I'll keep my mouth shut. Boyce Hydro hasn't done anything it's been asked to. Why are you asking them to carry out your decision on an alternative? It's clear safety hasn't been their top priority in the past. What makes you feel they would build the alternative spillway the way you're asking and the work would be done well? I don't think we're anticipating they're going to do that work. Am I correct?
Liesl, yeah, that's correct. They've not hit one deadline or met one milestone that we've asked. And so in the meantime, state government's been stepping up to take the action on. So I'll hand it off to Teresa because there are some statutory steps that we're working to make sure that we cross every T and dot every I on.
And Teresa, when you answer, can you also explain how, if this is unusual that the state is stepping in to do this, the work that a dam owner should be doing and how often this kind of thing happens?
Sure. So to start with Hugh's first question, it is unusual for us to have to step in and take over for a dam owner. Typically, when there is a problem with a dam, the dam owner, we issue an order or we issue some kind of documentation back to the dam owner to do some action, and the dam owner does it. In this case, Boyce has failed to step forward and take on the report that they were supposed to do the evaluation that Eagle has done. And in addition to that, it's going to mean that we're going to end up having to issue an emergency order, which is the next step in our enforcement process. So we anticipate issuing this emergency order to carry out the work that needs to be done to ensure that the dam, the remaining dam on the Tobacco side, is dewatered somewhat to a safety level so that we're ensuring that the public health and public safety is met. So that is unusual. It's actually extremely unusual, but we've been working very closely with Michigan Department of Transportation because they have a vested interest in this also, as well as the consultant AECOM from MDOT, as well as Four Lakes Task Force to carry out this. So the next step will be to have to issue an emergency order in order to be able to draw, to do this construction work that we hope to begin the engineering here shortly in the next couple of weeks, and then carry this out over the next few months so that we're down before the spring floods happen.
Good, thank you. I have a question from Kelly, and this is probably also for Luke. This is asking Luke to prognosticate if we have a good sense for what would happen if we get another big spring flood next year.
Sure, and that's kind of one of the unknowns, is that was part of the analysis we had directed Boyce to do as early as, you know, May, to start looking at those things. You know, what's the remaining structural integrity of the dam and what's the remaining hydraulic capacity of the dam to pass those flows? What would it look like during a flood? So we have some preliminary results from Boyce's engineer. Like I said, they did submit two reports. They fell short of the mark, but they did have some information which more or less confirmed our concerns, right? So we don't have exactly what it would look like. That's being finalized by AECOM right now. They're looking at the hydraulic and revising the hydraulic models so that we can understand what the water levels would be. And then their design would be to modify the dam so that those water levels don't raise above a level that's tolerable, you know, that's safe and that wouldn't cause additional damage or a failure of the dam in the future. So I don't have the exact answer. That will come shortly, I would think, through the design process.
Thank you, Luke. We have a follow-up from Jennifer Wilson. The emergency order, does that change the ownership of the dam? Does that mean the state is taking over the dam as owner, or would Boyce still own the dam and be responsible for upkeep after the state does the work?
So Boyce still owns the dam. We're going to step in and do an emergency order to do this action that Boyce should have done a couple months ago. So we're simply just coming in to do the work, and then Boyce will continue to maintain and own the dam until either some action is taken to change ownership.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm looking for more media questions. I have a couple of what look like municipal folks on. I'm reminding people we're trying to confine the questions here to to media, and we are glad to get back to municipal officials and others. Are there other media questions that we haven't answered? I have a hand up from a Courtney Bennett. I can't quite make out the outlet, but Courtney, do you want to unmute Courtney Jim, if you can, Courtney Bennett.
Go ahead, Courtney.
Okay, I'm from Mid-Michigan now, NBC 25 and Fox 66 in Flint. So if Boyce Hydro still owns the dam, will they be held accountable because the state ultimately will be paying for a job that they were responsible for?
So the answer is yes, they will still be held accountable. What normally happens in a situation where we have to issue an emergency order, which again is very rare, is that then we will turn those costs back over to Boyce to reimburse the state for. Now, obviously those things are a little, gonna be a little tumultuous right now as Boyce is filing for bankruptcy, but it's important to get this action done from a safety perspective. So regardless of if we're able to recoup the cost, it's important to ensure that we're protecting the safety of the citizens within the Wixom Lake area, but then also downstream. So the action's just critically important to get done.
Thank you. And Luke, Jennifer wants to be clear that she says Wixom Lake is empty now. Are you saying the construction will lower water levels on the other side, but not feed any water back into Wixom Lake? Is that correct, is the question from Jennifer.
Yeah, just to put a finer point on it, we consider the entire impoundment to be Wixom Lake, both the west side and the east side of M30, which we call the Tobacco side and the Tittabawassee side. So the west side or the Tobacco side is fed by the Tobacco River and will continue to be fed by the Tobacco River. And the east side is fed by the Tittabawassee River and will continue to be fed by the Tittabawassee River. Just given the nature of that, the water used to outlet on the west side of M30 now is running along the upstream face of the dam and ultimately to the breach on the far east, there is a sizable impoundment on the Tobacco side still intact. It looks a lot more like an impoundment than it does a river, whereas the Wixom or the Tittabawassee side looks a lot more like a river right now. So there would be some lowering of the water level on the Tobacco side. We would not expect any changes to the Tittabawassee River side of the impoundment.
Good. Thank you, Luke. Brittany, I'm going to pronounce her name wrong, Beauty, from TV7 and 4 has a question, and that is of the what is being done, and I just lost the question, but I think I remember it. Brittany, you can retype it if I don't get it right, but she's talking about the significant and high hazard dams that exist in Michigan, and what is being done now to make sure that those dams are safe and stable and that something like this doesn't happen again in another part of the state. Don't know which one of you wants to. I think all of you are capable of answering that question, so I'll let you do the grab bag.
If nobody wants it, I'll take it. But sure. So I think that high and significant hazard dams that are in bad shape have always kind of been the focus of our enforcement and compliance efforts, and they continue to be. So I think that anytime there's a large-scale failure of a high or significant hazard dam or any dam, it does make us take a closer look at those actions. And so we are following up on the worst case. I think probably if you've tuned into some of the previous press releases we've done where we identified some of the high and significant hazard dams that are not in great shape, those would be following up with the owner. Sometimes we already had a plan in place. It's just going to take some time to implement. And other times we're going to revise that plan to step up the compliance enforcement to try to compel the owner to do what needs to be done ahead of another dam safety emergency. So that's always the goal, and we're taking a closer look at that and working through the plans now. Like I said, some of that action was already in place prior to these failures, and we'll continue down those roads. Where we need to take more quick action, we'll do so kind of on a case-by-case basis.
Yeah, let me add to that. One of the components of the independent investigations we've articulated in the report is working with the Association of State Dam Safety Officials. An important part of that that came out through Gary's question and also through my comments early on is that helps us look critically at our program. So we want to make sure that We've thought about anything we can do to get better. We at Eagle know there's always opportunity to get better. And so we want to look at our program and figure out, you know, if there's additional budget, additional regulation, additional work that we can do to make sure that we're having an impact. So that's another piece of the work that we're doing. And you can see that articulated in the report.
Thank you, Liesl. I've lost a little track. Kelly House, can you unmute Kelly? Kelly, do you have another question or have we answered your question? I see you've got a hand up, but I don't know whether we already answered that particular question.
Sorry, yeah, that's a figment from my last question.
Okay, okay. I do have some questions from municipal officials and we have about 9 minutes left, so I can get to those if there are no other media questions. We're trying to confine it to media, but I don't see any other questions. And Jim, holler if you see something that I don't, but I don't see any other media questions in the chat box or hands raised.
Not yet.
Okay, I'm gonna, Mr. Robert North, who I believe represents a municipality, asks if we can get some lead, if they can get some lead time before additional lowering, noting that there are a lot of wells that are already compromised and any further lowering might affect the water table more, question mark, question mark. Also thanks to Dam Safety Crew for all their work. Luke or Teresa, can you speak to whether there will be lowering that might affect wells and what sort of notice might be provided to local folks?
Yeah, for sure. We'll be definitely doing a lot of outreach as we begin the actual construction part of this activity, but that's still a little bit off. So, you know, Bob, I know you're concerned with that. We're concerned with that too. And we have put into place some mapping to ensure we understand where those impacts might be. We'll be doing the engineering design here over the next few weeks, 4 to 6 weeks, and then looking to start the construction part. So we've got a little bit of time to work through that. We'll definitely be reaching out and communicating. And like I said, we've got the maps, the GIS map set up with Michigan Geological Survey and Esh from our department too. So we'll reach out to make sure you've got all the information you need. We don't want to see any more wells drawn down just like they did when the Wixom site was brought, the Tittabawassee side of the Wixom Lake was brought down.
Thank you, Teresa, and Mr. North says thanks also. I'm going to take this one. This is Brittany again. Follow-up question: besides the two dams that failed, what are the top priority dams right now? Top two or three that are most risk? Brittany, we have had that question a lot before, and I know that we have supplied media, and I would encourage you to email Nick Assendolf, and his contact information is on the screen there at the bottom. We do have, and you'll find on our website also a listing of all the dams that you can, that Michigan regulates, that you can break down and find out which ones are high hazard, which ones are significant hazard, which ones are in poor condition. There are no dams in the lowest condition, which is unsatisfactory, that are also high hazard dams. So that's good news. There are several that are in poor condition that are high hazard dams. And Luke and his team have addressed those over the most recent months. So we can provide you, I believe, are somewhere between 4 and 6 dams in that condition. We have the names of them and the status of them, and Nick can get you that information offline here. But that's a good question. We have another question about if somebody can go over the process for issuing an emergency order and how long it's expected to take.
So I'm going to let Luke handle kind of that. Luke's the only one that's done one that's still in the agency. So like I said, this is a pretty rare occurrence. So Luke, if you can kind of walk through the emergency order process and the time frame, that'd be great.
Sure. So under our authority under Part 315, we have the ability to issue emergency orders. It's a unilateral order, so basically it comes from Eagle directly to the owner, and then we give them some time frame to respond. If they don't, then we have the authority to step in and take necessary actions to alleviate the danger with the dam. It can be implemented pretty quickly, and I won't speak for the rest of the group, but I believe that's the intent here, is once we have the design and everything in place, and you know, we're working on a time frame that isn't very long, so I think it'll be an expedited process, and we will give the owner some chance to comply, but I think, like we stated earlier, we're not hopeful that that's going to happen, so it would probably be a very abbreviated time frame in which we could then implement our authority to step in and take the necessary action in a relatively quick time frame. Granted, this will be a pretty large project, so there will be some you know, bidding and emergency contracts that need to be in place. It will take some time, whereas you'll probably see movement in that direction in the next couple months, I would think.
Super. Thank you, Luke. Other questions? I have another question from what I believe is a municipal person, Mr. Kaplan, Heath Kaplan. Follow-up question on the lowering of the tobacco side of Wixom Lake. Does this impact the city of Beaverton and their hydro dam? Luke, can you speak to that?
Sure. So the impact at Beaverton would be that the tailwater would be lower because the impacts of the tobacco side dam at full pool, which it's probably down 15 feet or so from full pool elevation, does have some impact on the tailwater elevation at Beaverton. Other than that, I wouldn't expect any major impacts to the dam other than the water level in the river below the dam might see a slight decrease. But again, that's going to depend on how far the engineering analysis and how far that tobacco spillway will be lowered, you know, to give us the capacity and the safety at that dam needed to get us from here to the next long-term step of, you know, the dam reconstruction or whatever that might look like in the future. So I wouldn't expect any major impacts to the Beaverton Dam.
Great. I think we're done with questions, which is just as well because we have about 3 minutes left. Jim, do you see anything I don't see that hasn't been addressed yet?
Yeah, we got one more hand up, I think, Hugh.
Oh, is that Beth again?
Yeah.
Okay. Beth LeBlanc, can you unmute Beth? Unless that's already been addressed.
Okay, yeah, she's
not. Are you self-muted again? Oh. Beth, if you can hear us, it looks like you've muted yourself and you need to unmute or type your question in the chat box.
Hey, sorry about that. Can you guys hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Okay, I had a quick question. I think Luke actually may have just answered it, but when we're talking about changes to the Tobacco River side of the spillway, are those considered temporary, like the temporary measure to secure things at the dam and downriver, or would those be permanent changes even if there is a reconstruction of the Edenville Dam eventually?
Sure, thanks, Beth. I think that anything that's done right now is anticipated to be temporary in nature. So this would be to address the immediate concerns with as we move into the spring, where we could definitely get a better chance of high flows again, that the dam is stable and secure and that another failure event doesn't happen in the meantime. I do believe that the projection for a long-term solution is 4 to 6 years out. So that would be kind of we would consider a risk reduction measure to ensure the safety and stability of the dam, the reconstruction of M30, limiting of ongoing natural resource damages, et cetera, until that long-term solution can be designed, funded, and implemented. So it will be in place for some time, but I believe temporary on the order of, you know, that 4 to 6 year time frame until the long-term solution is chosen and implemented.
Thank you, Luke. So I think we're up to time, which is good because it looks like we're out of questions. Appreciate all of you coming. Stay tuned. We will, this is a marathon, not a sprint, to get these investigations completed, get some conclusions determined and some solutions moving forward. So keep in touch. We should be announcing the members of the task force coming up pretty soon. We have the ASDSO report, which will be ready sometimes this month. So there will be a lot of things trickling out. So keep in touch with Nick if you have follow-up questions. Even though he's a graduate of Central Michigan University, he is very capable and smart and responsive. He's muted, so he can't even fight back, and that was really unfair. But I'm sure I'll pay for it. So thank you all for coming. appreciate your time, and we'll be in touch moving forward on all these matters.